Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is such a great pleasure to see you again here tonight. I'm Maria Wolf, President of the World Affairs Council.
Okay. Oh, wow. How about that? Okay, now are you scared? Okay, do I need to go through that again? Hello, how are you? It's very nice to see you all. I'm Maria. Tonight is the final event of the World Affairs Council's 2014 International Speaker Series, Women Changing the World. It's been a great year. This landmark series has received more local, regional, and even national press coverage than any series we've had in the 14-year history. Wonder why that is. Maybe people like thinking about women. Thousands of people have come to hear four amazing women speak. One of them could be described as the most famous woman in America. The others are less well known to Americans, but they are equally outstanding and have done remarkable things in their own countries around the world. Hillary Rodham Clinton, Khalida Brohi, Lema Bowie, and tonight's speaker, Huang, have changed the rules of the game for women. Each has changed the social and political structure in her country in ways that will be felt for years to come. You know, it feels like this microphone is still not working right. Is it not right? Can someone address that? Sorry? A little more distance. Too close? How's that? Let go. All right. Looks like a very intimidating surgical instrument. Okay. So, back to where we were with our four fabulous women, from Washington, D.C., to rural Pakistan, to war-torn Liberia, to anything is possible China, coming up tonight. Each of these women has brought inspiring stories to us from around the globe. And, you know, it's your support that has made this possible. So on behalf of our entire community, our deepest thanks. Nothing's going right tonight. Our audience and sponsors have also made possible many other events with the Women Changing the World theme. Just last week, over 170 educators from school districts all over the state attended a day-long conference on women in the world, with 21 workshops on subjects as diverse as women in the media and the arts, economics, leadership, women in the trades. Teachers went away inspired and also loaded down with resources to use in their classroom. We were able to offer this at no charge to teachers, thanks to all of you. And we're not done yet. There will be lots of other events on this theme throughout the year, and our regular programming, of course, with the World Affairs Council, which is good reason to check out our website, www.worldoregon.org. One last thing before we move on to tonight's program, I would like to ask a favor of you. You'll see in the program tonight that there is an audience survey. It would mean the world to us if you filled it out. We really want to know who you are and what you think. Believe it or not, we're already starting to work on the 2015 International Speaker Series, and we need your input. Who would you like to see up on this stage next year? So tell us, please, and also tell us how and where you get information, how you communicate, so we can be more effective in our outreach efforts. To further encourage you to do this, we have a great prize. We'll have a drawing from the surveys, and the winning survey will receive tickets to next year's speaker series. Not a bad reward for just telling us what you think. Now, for the last time in the 2014 series, I have the privilege of thanking our wonderful sponsors. Nike, our lead sponsor, really stepped up to the plate and just did it. Portland State University. I have to repeat Portland State University because we love them so much, where knowledge serves the city. And our great series supporters, Delta Airlines, Wells Fargo Bank, and Mercy Corps. I'd also like to recognize, yes, they're all just great. Also, certainly the Heathman Hotel and our media sponsors, the Oregonian, Oregon Live, and Oregon Public Broadcasting. We are also very grateful to an amazing group of individuals. These are the change makers who are listed in your program. Their individual sponsorship supports not only the series, but many other programs of the council. Now is the time you know what to do with your cell phones. And by now, you probably also know how to ask a question of our speaker. There's a question card in your program. Just write your question on the card, pass it to the aisle, and ushers will pick up the cards at some point during the evening. Our current chair of the Council Board of Trustees, Hans van Alebeek, typically introduces our speaker, but he's out of town tonight, so we have asked our past chair, Ambassador Harriet Isom, to do the honors. Ambassador Isom is a world changer in her own right, a career foreign service officer who was ambassador to several countries when the State Department was really a gentleman's club. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Isom.
This evening's speaker, Huang, has become one of China's most influential figures in the realm of culture and media. She is known on the world scene as well, having been named by Time magazine in 2011 as one of the 100 most influential people. This is in part because she is bicultural. She has a uniquely dual perspective of Western and Eastern cultures. She interacts with both of them and is at the vanguard of the new media revolution in China. Huang is a publisher, media mogul, entrepreneur, TV presenter, journalist, author, film actor, and ever so modern, blogger with some 7.5 million followers. Her journey to innovation and success is a fascinating intertwinement of her family history, her sharp eye for business opportunity, and her witty flair for commentary and writing. When her mother, Zhang Hanjur, died in 2008, Oregon's own Nicholas Kristof wrote glowingly in his column of his admiration for her and friendship with her. Huang's mother was the beautiful daughter of a prominent Chinese intellectual, and she learned perfect English. She became Chairman Mao's English teacher and interpreter, working on Nixon's visit to China. Later in the Cultural Revolution, she was denounced as a lackey and collaborator of Madame Mao's Gang of Four and spent 2 years under house arrest. So, age 12, Huang was sent to study in the United States, where she spent her formative years being schooled in the famed Little Red Schoolhouse in Greenwich Village and later at Vassar College. She returned to live permanently in China in 1991, working at several state-owned factories. She says she never dreamed she would be a publisher or in the fashion business. But then, in 1998, she had the opportunity to take over the publication of a struggling high-end fashion magazine called Look, and renaming it iLook, she blazed a trail for several fashion magazines. They cater to the rising number of affluent Chinese consumers who are hungry for fashion and guidance, and that includes Chinese men who make up about 40% of her readership. As she comments, media entertainment was the last frontier in China's stunning modern development. First, the government opened up on agricultural policies, then land ownership, industry, services, and commerce. The last was media, and she positioned herself to take full advantage of it. She is the CEO of the China Interactive Media Group, As an entrepreneur, she launched in 2010 BNC, Brand New China, a retail nexus for up-and-coming young Chinese designers. She is a best-selling author, including her book, My Abnormal Life as a Publisher. And she is currently working on a memoir of her entire family and their extraordinary history. In 2005, she co-wrote and starred in an independent film, Perpetual Motion. She writes for the official Communist Party China Daily newspaper, as well as in the United States for Women's Wear Daily and The Daily Beast. She is director of China's first design museum, located in Beijing, that promotes alliances among Chinese designers, manufacturers, and retailers. She is delighted that China's new first lady, Peng Li Yuan, is showing off China's own fashions. In sum, Peng has brought her intelligence, joie de vivre, American practicality, and Asian charm and business acumen to Chinese media in the 21st century. So please join me in welcoming Peng Huang to share her vision on China today and tomorrow.
Hi, everyone. It is a great honor to be here, especially looking at the speakers before me, so I hope I live up to certain expectations and won't let you down. I think talking about China is not an easy subject anymore. There was a time when people didn't know much about China and speakers about China couldn't make up any story. You can say things that people will say, oh, is that what China is like? But nowadays, with internet, with everything online, it is very difficult to find things that will be either inspiring or new to tell people. So I think I want to give you my perspective on China. First of all, I live in China. I'm a U.S. citizen, but I was born in Beijing, so I chose really to live in China. And I read the Western press by acquiring a VPN and what we call climb the wall and get outside and read all the reports about China. And sometimes we are flabbergasted ourselves about the things that are happening in China. And we're shocked and thought, oh gosh, these are terrible. And we do hear about, and there's a grapevine on social media and so on and so forth. So needless to say, probably the Chinese government in certain aspect is the worst representative of the Chinese people, especially the young people. We are fighting against pollution, we're fighting against certain very conservative ideas about how society should be run, and we are always looking to find wisdom in traditional China, which right now is being destroyed very quickly. My work with young creative talent in China is very much to try to find a new Chinese identity, a sort of a 21st century Chinese notion of who we are and who we really want to stand for. So today, my presentation is named China at 26. Why 26? Because I work with a group of 40 young people, and their average age in my company is 26. So I really want to present their works to you and what we do and the creative China that we do. And hopefully, and unfortunately, this is not what the New York Times and Washington Post and all the Western press want to report about. I talk to these reporters all the time, including Nicholas Kristof, and say, can't you just write about these young people? They're really quite inspiring. But other priorities, I suppose, politics and numbers. So I don't have any numbers about GDP or growth or, you know, or horror stories about, you know, Ai Weiwei, or I just want to talk to you about China and the young people, average age 26. So, I don't know, can you see this? Okay, these are photos of my entire editorial of I Look magazine. And so they're all very young, as you can see. So I'm going to tell you their story or our story. This is the city we live in. And this is the image that you see in the West. And out of 365 days, I think about 200 days are like this. And the rest, they are a little bit like Portland today. And we absolutely live for those one third of the time of the year where we can actually breathe. So it's not an easy country. And what you see in this slide, the building, is the CCTV tower. And CCTV is Central China. It's the main television station in China. Anyway, government owned, very powerful, authoritarian voice of China. When this building was built, it's by Rem Koolhaas, I was an anchor person, and I invited a friend of mine, Yong Ho Chan, who was at the time chair of the architecture department of MIT, to come and speak on my talk show, and talk about this building. And he said something very interesting. He said, Huang, you know, our culture is disappearing around us. He said, Rem Koolhaas is a very good friend of mine. I love his design, very brave, very new, but you know, let me tell you something about this building. This new CCTV building, because it's for CCTV, it is protected against earthquake on the Richter scale of 8. Now, the rest of the building in Beijing, including Forbidden City and so on, all the other buildings, are only protected up to a Richter scale of 7. And he said to me, he said, Huang, I just want you to know, nothing against Rem Koolhaas, nothing against modern architecture. Just in case of a huge earthquake in Beijing, which has happened before, this is the only structure that will stand to represent Chinese culture. Are you happy with that? So, needless to say, that particular episode got canned and censored and taken off air by the censors. And this had repeatedly happened about 4 or 5 times during my tenure as a TV anchor woman until I finally had enough and quit. So I quit to focus more on my magazine and working with younger people. And mostly we don't deal with television stations because they're government owned and they're very difficult to deal with. So we make videos and we put it on the internet and for everybody to see. And this has been a great way for us to communicate. Despite the fact that Facebook and Twitter are not allowed in China, I want you to understand the reality in China is not that we don't have internet. You guys all know about parallel universe. The truth is, we actually have a parallel universe on the internet. So if you have Twitter, we have Weibo. You have Facebook, we have Renren. You have Instagram, we have Nice. And there's the Chinese basically established a wall. And it's like a mirror reflection of the virtual world that exists outside of China, except that in the China version of it, the government has much tighter control. So what I'm about to show you are videotapes that we have made about Chinese youth, which did get on Chinese internet and had a very wide reach. And we are very proud of being able to do that. But before anything, I want to introduce you to our 24-year-old filmmaker. His name is Gong Zheng. He comes from Shandong province. And he, at the age of 24, runs our entire video division and produces one video per week to be loaded up on Youku, which is the Chinese answer to YouTube. Youku, YouTube. And so even the names, you know. And I think it's a little bit science fiction story-ish. So he went to university to study animation in Sichuan province in Chengdu. And when I found him on the internet, I have a Weibo account, and he wrote to me and said, I like what you write, can you take a look at my video? I did, and it was fantastic. It was simple, clean cut, very straightforward, and well presented. So I wanted to hire him, and he came to Beijing, except he hasn't graduated from college yet. And if I hired him, I would be violating about 10 different labor codes in China. So I had to properly send him back to Sichuan to finish his college. And then he came. And when he came, he said, Huang, I want to make video about people who are my age. I don't want to make video about older generations, celebrities, and people like that. I want to make video about people my age. I said, okay, that's fine. We're all about young people. And he said, but there's another thing. I said, what is it? He said, I want to make video not about mainstream Chinese culture. I don't like what all the government promoted culture, it seems very fake. I want to make video about real people and real culture. And he has been doing that once a week about designers, artists. And the video that I'm going to show you had more than a million hits within about a week. And it went very viral on Youku in China. And it's a video that he made about modern dance in China. It's not very long. Unfortunately, I was unable to get subtitles. There are little interviews. Modern dance, let me explain to you a little bit about modern dance. Modern dance is not recognized by the state as an art form. I mean, please don't ask me why in the questions. I mean, the Chinese government sometimes is way beyond logic. You know, I can't explain what they do and how they think. So, anyways, modern dance is not recognized. So the state actually does not fund any modern dance troupes. All modern dance troupes has to be funded either privately or by corporate sponsorship. So modern dancers have a very difficult time in China in terms of getting rehearsal space, getting their voices heard, getting their performances into theaters. Because being able to play in a theater, you need so many levels of government approval. And if you're not a government-condoned arts group, it becomes that much more difficult. So we interview these modern dancers. They're the key players in China's modern dance troupes. And the numbers you will see is how many years they've practiced dance. And the interview is really about how difficult it is to practice modern dance and how much they love it. A lot of them go through this thing and tell you, most of them come from their parents, or one of their parents are dancers, and that's how they started in dancing. To the point where modern dance is such a fringe, marginal thing that their parents would dissuade their children from continuing modern dance, except that these kids persevered, and they give many reasons of why they persevered. And there's one reason that stands out is that they're passionate about dance.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I hope someday, though, there will be a modern dance troupe that will be able to play in Portland for all of you. But this video was very emotional for all of us, and I look, because what these modern dancers go through represents young Chinese designers, young Chinese artists, all of them trying to break out, trying to be passionate about their work, and trying to continue their work in a very difficult environment. And I think this makes my work actually very worthwhile in China. Another thing I want to talk to you about Chinese young people is they do have historical baggage. This is an image of the Cultural Revolution. Now, in Chinese media, you're not allowed to talk about Cultural Revolution. There has been a recent film by Zhang Yimou, the famous Chinese director, called The Return. And the story is actually, the time period is Cultural Revolution, but the way that he told the story actually made it much more a love story, a romantic story, a sentimental story, rather than having any political references. And probably that is why that it was allowed to be publicly screened. But the Cultural Revolution is a baggage that all of us carries. And for a lot of you, you might think, you know, for someone my age, we remember the Cultural Revolution, we know what it's like, and we do it. But it actually, that's not true. For a 24-year-old, it is still a very, very heavy, heavy load. So I want to introduce you to Crystal Gao, who is our fashion editor at iLook. And she's in, if you see her, she is a total fashionista. She is the it girl, and she dresses wild, fabulous, you know. She's always ready for photographers and latest style and everything. So, but on the other hand, it's not easy for her because she carries the story of her family, which is a lot of baggage. This is her grandfather. As you can see, her grandfather was a very high-ranking official. He's photographed next to Mao, and he is on Tiananmen for big state ceremonies. His name is Gao Gang, and he is the first communist official to fall from grace since 1949. And when he fell hard. He actually committed suicide. Since then, a lot of communist officials who were persecuted, condemned during the Cultural Revolution, have been rehabilitated, except for Gao Gang. We don't know the reason why. There are books writing about him. As you can see, Crystal Gao's grandmother, Gao Gang's wife, is still alive, and that's a picture of her. And she has been pleading, and her son has been pleading to actually to have her husband's name, Crystal's grandfather's name, rehabilitated in China. And it has been very difficult. So when Crystal decided to work for iLook as fashion editor, I made a very strange decision, partly out of, I don't know, I think partly for me is out of support for her to deal with her family, is we put her on the cover. She is our cover girl for 2014, which caught a little bit of attention by local press. And they would ask her questions about who she is, and she would inevitably explain that she's the granddaughter of Gao Gang. And then they would all the local press would call me to say, we can't print that story, Huang, because her grandfather is Gao Gang. So for a 24-year-old, she has to deal with that stigma. And she deals with it in extremely well in stiletto heels, I have to say. And she trots on. You know, she's a brave 24-year-old. And I say to her, I say, Crystal, how are you feeling? You know, are you okay? This whole thing about your family. And she looked at me and she said, Auntie Huang, don't we all have a story to tell? Isn't every family in China some way tragic? Why should mine be any different? I don't care if the state media doesn't want to talk about it. I am who I am, and I like what I do. And this is the kind of spirit that young people have in China. It's not violent, but they are changing they start by changing their own lives, and they start being strong themselves, especially if you're a woman, and by being able to get more control of their lives and not let anything exterior to influence their mood, what they do, they march on in stiletto heels. And so this is Crystal Gao's story. The next story is that I want to talk about the destruction of culture around us, which is very serious concern to Chinese young people. This is a artwork by a Chinese artist called Zhang Dali. He's a graffiti artist, and that little head is his signature. And he goes to places where city planning has condemned. City planning is more like organized. There's a joke in China. Let me tell you this joke among kids. And they said, well, you know, there are terrorists sent to bomb Chinese cities. So when they got to Beijing, they got lost on the ring road because the signage is so bad. So they were unable to carry out their plan. And so when they went back to their terrorist group, they were all executed for bad execution. Then they sent another group and said, oh, since Beijing highway is so complicated, why don't you go bomb Tianjin? And they went back and very downtrodden and said to the terrorist leader, we're sorry, somebody got there before us and it's bombed already. And this is when Tianjin was under huge government plan reconstruction. And it looked like that somebody had actually committed a horrible act of terrorism. So that was the joke that was going around in China in terms of destruction of historical monuments or old buildings. I was just told about how this building was saved in Portland. So I'm very proud to be making this presentation here in this well-preserved building. So bravo, Portland. Good for you. So, but amidst all that ruins, there are young people who are trying to revive what craftsmanship are and what was left of Chinese traditional culture and the way of life, perhaps that has given birth to great philosophers like Laozi, like Zhuangzi. And the young people are actually searching for that. And one of them is a young guy, 23-year-old, graduated from Vassar in 2011. First year he majored in film, second year he did philosophy, third year he decided to do finally in his junior year, he decided to do East Asian studies, and when he graduated, he got a grant to travel around the world and learn about dance around the world in different ethnic cultures. So when he arrived back in Beijing in 2012 and told me about his experience, I said, well, you're perfectly unemployable by now because you know everything and nobody knows where your focus are. But it made him a perfect editor because he has the most curious mind and he is very determined to discover what he believes is traditional Chinese culture, and he is very adamant about reviving some of it. So his first assignment that he proposed to me was to go around China and find craftsmen who are reviving old Chinese craft, but using modern design and combining modern design and traditional craftsmanship to make new things for the modern day China. So the following video is his video about young craftsmen in China. And again, you see the fact that they, because they're craftsmen, they're young, they have their own studios, they're outside of the governmental system. And but they're very happy people, and they're very passionate about their craft. And in it, there's a couple, and the girl is actually from Korea, South Korea, and she went to Jingdezhen, famous for porcelain production in China. So I'm sorry that the subtitles are not there, but if you'll see some of their crafts. And there's one guy, that one thing I should tell you, he was holding up a jar that he creates, and he said that he loves Chinese pottery because half of it is created by man and half of it is created by nature. And that's the epitome of the Chinese philosophy of life. So I hope you enjoy this little. This is actually a studio that takes old Chinese craftsmen in making umbrella, and they're making chairs. So I know that, thank you. So I know that there are lots of artists and craftsmen in Portland. So I think when I told Peng Cheng that I'm coming to speak here, he actually rushed this out. This has not been released on Chinese internet yet. We haven't released it on, and he said, you have to show this to them. You have to tell them there are kindred souls in China. So these are the Chinese I work with. And I often see titles like, is China is a threat to the West, China is friends to the West. And I think the young people that I work with, and myself sometimes, if we are completely entrenched in our world, do not understand the perspective of these questions. Because we think we're just exactly like you guys. We don't think we're that different. We love the same thing. We're passionate about great things. We're passionate about improving our lives and so on and so forth. So I think one of the notions that we hope to introduce by sharing culture and by sharing beautiful things with each other is to try to somehow erase the boundary between you and me, and to be able to feel that we can all identify as people who want the same thing, who share the same passion. So one of the things that I want to talk about, and one of the reasons I chose this presentation, is that we stop thinking of China as a country, but we start thinking about China as people. And really, thank you. And you know, I have to be funny. I found this cartoon and I think at the end of the day, we are kind of alike, aren't we? So this is one of the cartoons that I thought was quite indicative of the future. So there's really nothing new about China that I can tell you anyway. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Huang. It's really very interesting to hear a presentation on culture. We do a lot of politics here, and this is a nice change from the norm. We have questions for you that span the range from culture to some politics. But I think to start, what do we have here? We have an audience member who would like to know, how different is it to be 52 in China instead of 26?
I'm 53, so
oh.
Last year, I'll try to remember how I felt last year.
53 is fine.
For, yeah, 53, can we deal with 53?
We can deal,
slightly
yeah.
Older? Okay, yeah. It's harder, you are more concerned about environmental issues at 53, because really last year was the first year that my lungs really felt the pollution. And I used to hate this Chinese habit of coughing and spitting. I mean, I'm sure you guys have heard of it, of hoiking mucus and then spit. I couldn't stand it. It just drove me nuts when people that did that. And I just thought, ugh, God, how can they do that? It's so disgusting. And last year, because of the pollution, I found myself thinking, you know, I actually understand why Chinese spit so much. So I don't know whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, but yes, at 53, you begin to be much more tolerant of a lot of things, including the awful habit of spitting.
Can you explain to us how media censorship works in China? Are there stated rules for what may and may not be covered? And what is the role of internet nannies?
It's a very complicated thing. How much time do I have now?
Yeah, all the time you want.
Okay. The censorship is there are rules and there are certain policies, but they're not written because the Chinese government is very clever. At the very beginning in the 1950s, they decided written law actually binds them as much as it binds the people that they want to rule. So it's better, since they have the power, not to have written rules and just make up rules to allow certain things and not allow certain things as they go. So there are written rules, but it is in the form of a directive. So it's a letter that circulates around, and it goes on the hierarchy. So if it is the director of the propaganda ministry of the Communist Party who issued this, it will go to maybe bureau chiefs and head of television, and then from the head of television to producers, and from producers, and on and on. But it's a piece of paper. It's not law. It's not anything. It's just rules for this month, rules for May 2014. And the funny story, let me tell you, is when China, Hunan Television is one of the most popular television entertainment channels in China, and it's still state-owned. They copied American Idol as the format and did this Chinese program called The Supergirls. Or is this Supergirl? I think it's called The Supergirls. And it's exactly American Idol, except it's all women singers competing in the show. And the Supergirl, and you can vote. And the Supergirls were such a huge hit in China that I think when the show was on, something like 2/3 of China was watching. The ratings were through the charts. And this alarmed the government. And the fact that you can actually vote, you know, with your mobile phone, that's awful, you know? And so this alarmed the government, and so they started to issue directives to say, okay, no more voting, you can't do this, we're moving you from prime time to 11 o'clock at night, you cannot do this, you cannot do that. So they start giving all kinds of directives of the show. Now, somebody at the show obviously didn't like these directives and took one of those papers and slipped it to the foreign press. The next day, you know that New York Times, everybody had this to say, this is the Chinese directive, and they had a copy of it in the newspaper. And then I know the director of the show, Supergirl, and she said to me, she said, it was so ridiculous. After that piece of paper was leaked, it became that they refused to show them the piece of paper. She would be called in by her station master and say, for today, there are 21 rules that you have to take care of. I'm going to read it to you. You cannot take notes. You have to memorize them. And he would start reading, and she would be there saying, you must be kidding. You want me to follow this, and you don't allow me to take notes. You don't give me anything. And she said it got to the point when the Supergirl program was so powerful in China that that's the way they monitored it. But that's pretty extreme, and that's the way that censorship works in China. It is sometimes very comical. Internet nannies is a different story. Internet nannies, I mean, there are so many of them. I think some Weibo, they hire something like 4,000 of them sitting in the back room, and there's a very powerful software which has sensitive words. So if these words are posted by anyone on Weibo, that particular posting will go directly to the nannies, and the nannies will read it and make sure that nothing is wrong with the sentence, and then they'll let it go onto the internet. Now, the problem is that Chinese characters is very complex. For a while, there were lots of rumors about the last head of state, Hu Jintao. And his last name is Hu, and the way you write it is the same word as carrot, Hu Luobo. So for a while on Chinese internet, you can't write 胡萝卜, if you write carrot, it immediately goes to the nannies and your postings will not see the light of day. So things like that happen, and even today, they're really chaotic things, and that they're just words that are synonyms. And for example, there was the jasmine movement, so you cannot search for jasmine tea on Chinese internet because jasmine is a sensitive word. So that's how it's ruled. And it provides plenty of humor for us.
The U.S. recently indicted 5 members of the Chinese People's Liberation Army for cyber espionage. They were accused of hacking into systems of at least 3,000 U.S. companies and agencies, largely for the purpose of gaining commercial advantage. China was outraged and withdrew from the bilateral working group that was the only venue dedicated to cyber issues. The U.S. differentiates between spying for national security reasons, which it deems okay, and spying to gain a commercial advantage, not okay. Do Chinese recognize this distinction? Is the U.S. viewed as simply hypocritical?
Seriously? I think being a U.S. citizen living in China and watching this bantering going on, I don't know. Sometimes I think we're ruled by 5-year-olds on both sides.
Why did you give up your Chinese citizenship?
I gave up my Chinese citizenship in 1990, and it was the year after 1989, June 4th, Tiananmen Square. And that was something that was actually right after June 4th happened, I wanted to go back to China because I wanted to make sure my family is okay, particularly my mom. And my mom is a very dignified and civilized woman. She has never threatened me in her entire life. She's never tried to control my life. And when I said I wanted to go back to China in November 1989, she threatened me. She said, if you come back to China, I will hang myself at Beijing Airport. And this coming from my mom, I think I got the message. And I said, well, under what condition can I come back and see you? She said, get a U.S. citizenship, and then you can come back. And I won't hang myself at the Beijing airport. So I think at the time, for most Chinese, it was that bad. It was a time that you feel that your life was threatened. You feel that the government could do anything, and they're violent and they're vicious, and there was this tremendous fear, which actually right now doesn't exist. And the young people right now is struggling to understand the fear at the time. So why did I give up Chinese citizenship? That's why.
Does the fact that you are an American citizen allow you to be more outspoken than other Chinese?
Yes and no. I suppose I'm not exactly, because I'm not under a Chinese administrative rule, but I am, like any foreigner, a guest to China. I need a visa to be in China. Now, my daughter and my partner are both Chinese citizens, so in some ways, if I lose my visa, I also lose the right to be with my family. So, yes and no.
China's policy of gender equality has liberated women's productivity. Women count for 45% of the labor force. But according to a 2011 survey of urban Chinese, 70% thought it was better for a woman to find a good husband than to find a good job. Is there a culture of feminism or women's activism in China?
It is beginning to catch on, especially on the internet, and especially with young people. One of the reasons that I work with young people in China is because I think they do offer hope for China. For my generation of people, and for probably people who are 10 years younger than me, anyone over 35, unfortunately, fortunately, I shouldn't judge, but their number one role model is not me. It's Wendy Deng. So I think what you have said is very true in China, because it's very difficult for women in the workplace, despite the fact that they are a huge percentage of the workforce. They're constantly discriminated against. If I go to hire, I once was with a competitor, another magazine, a gentleman who runs a very successful magazine and media program in China, and we were both hiring people. And I was hiring sales director, and he was hiring sales director. And he just openly said to me, he goes, "You need a pretty girl to be a sales director. She has to be willing to sleep with clients." And I was horrified that this guy, who's the owner of a large media group, would openly proclaim that. He did hire two gorgeous looking women to work for him as sales directors. And he then basically, tried to sleep with both of them. And one of them, who's a very feisty young lady, said, "Look, I know you like me, and I know you wouldn't mind taking me into your bedroom, but let me tell you something, I like several men at the same time. If you can deal with that, I'm fine with it." And that actually just completely threw him off, and he never, ever made any sexual comment or did anything of the sort to her again. So I think women are now looking, find ways to stand up for themselves.
Who have your role models been?
My role model. I love reading Bertrand Russell. So he's one of my greatest philosophers. And I think he has always enlightened me. When I'm enthusiastic, it's a good sort of reminder of what the world, it's a good reminder about caution. And when I'm down, it's always good to read also, because he inspires. So I don't think he's a role model, but his work definitely inspires me quite a bit. My role model, well, Hillary Clinton, for example. Yes. And I think in China, we had our own version of a Hillary Clinton in the form of Wu Yi, who was a vice premier. And she was the only woman who succeeded in that position. And I know there are probably Chinese men in the audience, but I have to say Chinese men sometimes are such a wimps, you know. If they have problem with Japan, all the men who are chairman, president, and premier all say, you go to Japan and solve the problem. If there are problem with American in trade negotiation, it's, you go to America and solve the American problem. And she probably during her time as vice premier were assigned the most difficult negotiations ever in modern day China. And then she refused to play politics, so she actually resigned from her, she didn't resign, she retired, but she did something that was unheard of, because when a government official retire, a lot of privileges will continue, which means that if you're not the vice premier, you become the head of some association, you become on the board of state-owned enterprises. She is the first government official to say, I want what is now known in China as a naked retirement, which means I want to retire completely. I don't want to continue the privileges. I want to go back to being a private citizen. So as a woman, she's also, as a politician, she also set a extremely good example for the rest of the men, except they didn't follow her.
We hear of poor working conditions in clothing factories in China, certainly elsewhere too, but certainly China. Does the world of fashion offer opportunities for poor and working class Chinese?
I think Chinese factories in fashion are actually disappearing very fast. Because the cost of labor is very high. And because of the poor conditions, there are sort of massive economic repercussions when you don't offer proper working conditions for workers, because they don't come back. And right now, one of the major problems for Chinese garment producers is to hire qualified workers for these workshops. I visited a Chinese brand called Icicle, and the owner, which is a couple, it's a private company, they revamped their entire factory, and they are in a very nice building, which is actually an office building, and the workers are working in very good condition. And I asked him about the cost and how he can afford to do that. And he said if he didn't improve the conditions, he would actually have zero worker in the workshop right now.
China has managed to liberalize its economy spectacularly, while at the same time maintaining an authoritarian political system. Is more political liberalization inevitable, or can this two-part system continue indefinitely?
I don't know. It depends on what day it is. You know, on Mondays, I think, no, it can't continue. On Tuesdays, I think, you know, maybe it will last because it's Chinese. You know, I have no idea, to tell you the truth, because it's one of those things that probably just makes scholars, political scientists, really want to bang their heads on the wall, because when you liberalize the economy and have a market system, what is always assumed is a democratic system will come about. But I personally think culturally, Chinese crave stability. And so the word tolerance for you means a tolerance in society of diversity, of different ways of life. Tolerance in China means tolerating the tyrannical rule as long as they provide stability. So, and we're very good at tolerance.
Which leads to another question. Is democracy overrated?
Again, it's one of those things that for people who live in China, democracy is definitely not overrated. But for people who live in China and watch House of Cards, it is definitely overrated.
In the US, there is rising concern about income inequality. Some say if the gap continues to widen unchecked, it will threaten the middle class and destabilize democracy. Certainly, income inequality is a great issue in China as well. Is this perceived as a problem that could compromise China's future?
It is a problem that will compromise Chinese stability, because for Chinese, everything is about balance, stability. So I think this discrepancy in income is creating huge amount of social tension in China. And a great amount of unhappiness. So ultimately, it will, well, what it has done, actually, it is forcing the current government to deal with it. And one of the ways that it is dealing with it is the anti-corruption campaign. So I think social inequality in China is a huge problem, except, again, I think the Chinese are, in general, more submissive. They're not so sensitive to, I mean, they are sensitive to it, but China never had a democracy. For 5,000 years, they had to put up with this kind of inequality and elitism. And so the average Chinese is probably, in some ways, can psychologically accept inequality much more so than, say, an average American.
You quoted a friend of yours who said, "We used to learn English to understand the world. Now we learn English to understand China." Can you explain that?
Well, you know, it's very simple, because if you don't read English, half of the things that's going on in China, you won't be able to know, because you have to read it in English. You have to read it in English on the internet. You have to read the New York Times and Wall Street Journal and things like that, and to get the report on China. For example, just is it last year or the year before last, there was this huge political struggle in China with this guy called Bo Xilai. I think everybody knows him as Bo, you know. So the whole Bo scandal in China was very hush-hush, and nobody talked about it. So unless you had access to Western press and could read Western press, and you actually have more of an idea what is going on at extremely high echelon in China.
You have said that of all the artists you know, Ai Weiwei, a very outspoken man, provocateur and dissident, is the only one who deep down cares about his country. Can you expand on that?
Well, I think Weiwei is a very successful artist. He has many options in life. He doesn't need to stay in China, but he chooses to. He doesn't need to stay Chinese, but he chooses to. He doesn't need to be, you know, before 2008, he was invited by the Chinese government to start art programs and studios and lead the campaign for Chinese Olympics and so on and so forth. So if he had chosen to work with the government, he would be one of those artists that is heavily promoted by the government. But then again, he knew that he had to change the way that he created his art. He could not do what he wanted. So what he chose was he decided to preserve his integrity as an artist, and he chose not to work with the government. And he actually started his studio by working with a lot of young people and doing a lot of artwork that is very provocative to the Chinese government, to the extent that he got arrested. But I think he cares deeply about China. I think that all those are actions of a man who deeply care about his country versus a corrupt official who takes the money, sends their sons and daughters to universities overseas, and eventually will leave China. I mean, that is something that is not only clear to me, but also clear to every single average Chinese, that most officials, or not most, I should say, certainly there are, the dissidents care more about China way more than people who are in power.
We have several questions about environmental issues in China. The gist of it is, do you think there's any hope?
(Clears throat) There's always hope. Well, you know, in Beijing, when there's a smog, we hope there's wind. So we'll blow the smog out, and we don't have a smog anymore. Things like that.
So, okay. We won't wait around.
We will just have to. I think the government is now very clearly aware of the extent of pollution as a social problem in China. So much so that the head of state actually during one particular very smoggy day decided to tour Beijing and shake hands with the public to show that he is actually breathing the same air that we're breathing, that he's not in an oxygen tank. So I think awareness is the first thing. So let's see what happens.
With the recent signing of the deal to ship Russian gas to China, are we seeing a new China-Russian friendship, maybe even a new power axis?
I don't know. I work in the cultural realm. I think China needs gas. Russian has lots of gas. And what's the big deal? No.
Okay. How would your life have been different? Had you not been educated in the U.S., how would your life have been different?
If I wasn't educated in the U.S., I really sincerely believe I would be a spoiled brat in China because I actually come from a very privileged family in China. My grandfather was a friend and teacher of Mao, and my mother was his interpreter and English teacher. I grew up in a huge courtyard house in the center of Beijing. We had cars when nobody had cars. We had the first television. And so there were lots of privileges around. I've seen people who are also sort of grew up in the same environment, and sometimes I see them, and a lot of them I find them intolerable. They would do anything and say anything to preserve their self-interest, and they'd be able to use the fact that they have family connections and that they're within the system. They would be able to use that network so well to gain personal wealth and so on and so forth. I'm probably known in China as one of those people who is known for wasting my family resources and refusing to take advantage of it. So I'm, in some ways, I'm a total failure. And if I didn't come to America, I wouldn't be such a failure.
It's fair to say that no country in history has changed as fast in two or three decades as China. So what do you think China will look like in 20 more years?
I hope there'll be a systematic change in China in the fact that the Chinese will learn to peacefully become more democratic in the way that it governs, be it the Communist Party or whatever, that the ruling government will learn to be kinder to its people, to learn how to build a society that will support itself. 20 years might be a little bit not enough time, maybe 50 years.
I'd like to ask you about Chinese values. Under a Confucian system, everything was spelled out and legislated. This was debunked by Mao and replaced with red book rhetoric. But now, what now? Is it all about money? What is the moral compass?
I think in terms of looking for a moral compass, China is a little bit lost. I think you see the young people that I feature today in my presentation, they're in their 20s and maybe early 30s, and they're looking for that new value system that they could be proud to say, I am Chinese. But for the past 30 years, and this, I think, America was a horrible influence in China. It's all about money. It's just only money. Everybody, you take Wall Street and you basically, they made every single Chinese think like a wolf on Wall Street, you know? And this is 1.4 billion people crazy about money, and this creates havoc. But that is basically for the past 30 years what we experienced in China.
We hear many horror stories about corporate malfeasance in China, adulteration of food, even baby formula, use of shoddy building materials, even for an elementary school. Is this exaggerated by the Western press, or is there a real lack of social responsibility in the Chinese business world?
Well, needless to say, I think social responsibility is a issue in China. Most of the cases, how should I put it? I think large private businesses are actually more socially responsible than state enterprise, and more responsible than very small operations that might do a lot of things to cut corners and ignore public safety issues to make money. But then again, that has a lot to do with poverty in China, with the fact that legal administration, the lack of it, and also it has to do with officials being corrupt. So it's a combination of things. And yes, corporate responsibility is very bad, but ultimately, I think the responsibility lies with the Chinese government in the fact that their FDA equivalent in China is not working. The fact that, you know, I once had a friend who actually became a filmmaker, but he was in the pharmaceutical business. And he said that, he told me something that he said, you know, for the American FDA, it takes about something like 3 years or 4 or 5 years or even longer to approve a particular drug and to put it on the new market. And he says, the Chinese FDA, on the average, puts out 500 new drugs every day. Oh. And he said, and the Chinese FDA has 1/3 of the manpower of the American FDA. They have no lab. And he says, so I don't need to say anything. You know what's going on in that particular administration. And so I think ultimately the system is not working, and that's what has to be corrected.
In commenting about the age-old domination of men in Chinese society, you once said, Chinese men have lived largely unchallenged, so their capacity has diminished. It's like an animal that doesn't hunt and is served everything on a silver platter. It deteriorates and gets weak. Would you like to expand on that?
It's true, you know. Chinese men are so backward in the sense that, you know, if you are in a family, if you're born a boy and a girl, the boy gets everything, right? So you don't need to work. Well, first of all, you don't have siblings anymore, but okay. During the days when we had siblings, the boy usually gets everything. And you know, if the family is short on money, the boy is sent to college, not the girl. And if it's primary school, it's always about the boy. And now that they're the only child, and if it's a boy, it is pampered by two sets of grandparents and the parents, and that is truly a prince. And when it gets to schools, basically the teachers and in high schools would openly say, I went to one of the high schools because I went to Vassar, and I sit on the board of Vassar, so one of my trustee duties is to go to Chinese high schools and recruit students for Vassar. And I went to a school which is one of the best high schools in Beijing. And I sat there and listened to a speech by the principal, who obviously is a Chinese man, and said he said to the entire graduating class, he says, today we have Huang here to talk about her alma mater, Vassar, which is a women's college. So I have to correct her to say, no, it's actually co-ed now. And he said, well, I want to tell you, all the senior class, all the men, your brain and your head, we have educated you well for being engineers and scientists and captains of industry. Now, for all the girls, if you can find a good husband, going to Vassar is a good option. And of course, I just went up, and that's actually where I said Chinese men are spoiled and they don't know how to hunt. And that, you know, he made that speech, and I came up after him to say, okay, let me give you my theory about Chinese men. So I'm very proud to take all the Chinese girl who want to apply to Vassar.
For our last question, we've developed a bit of a tradition here this year for the speaker series. We have a young person's question. And this young person is Eddie Binford Ross, who is in the fifth grade at Heritage School. Sounds like Eddie is a boy. Eddie, are you here?
Hi, Eddie.
Okay. But Eddie's question is, girl? Okay. That makes this question even more logical. What advice do you have for the female children of the world today?
Be strong and be independent. That's what my mom told me, and it's worked. And I hope it will work for you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.